It wasn't Tabuk. And he was pointing to Al-Yam, right? And that they said it refers to Mecca. Well, the right? The people of Yemen didn't want the good news will come. So some said he was in Tabuk and he was pointing towards Yemen, and he really means there is Mecca and Medina. Of course, there's no better place than Mecca and Medina. The majority, of course, of the Ramadan, they said, no, this is as the Prophet said like this. And it's also coming in the hadith, Iman Yemen. The faith is Yemen, right? So he mentioned the Yemen by its name. And the hadith that talks about the virtue of Hashem, for example, you know, the Palestine, Lebanon, Syria, and so on. And there's a hadith, few hadith about Misr, you know, like this. So it means that this is, you know, the Iman is there, but the Iman is based on the actions of the people and their belief, which is, of course, consensus among the ulama that you might have a place that is being praised, but in these places are evil people. And Mecca and Medina, there were disbelievers in Mecca and Medina. So the place itself is not as significant, but it means there is good people there, as it will come even more hadith where their hearts are softer and so on. This is if the people are like this. But things can change, and again it's according to the actions of the people. Like one time, Abu Darda, he was in Asham. And he sent to Salman al-Farisi, saying to him, Halumma ila al-ardi muqaddasa. Come to the Holy Land. Right? Asham. So Salman al-Farisi replied to him, said, Inna al-ardha la tuqaddisu ahadan. Innama yuqaddisu al-insan amalu. He said, the earth does not make anyone holy. The land does not make those who are living on it holy or virtue or anything. But instead, the action of the person, this is what makes them virtuous. Right? So the criteria is the action. The land itself does not make those who are living on it holy or not. And Ramadan, I mentioned in the tafsir, the explanation of tahif, many things, and one of which is time can change in a place where it's mentioned to be, for example, like the Prophet ﷺ pointed toward the east, where usually the fitna comes from the east side of Mecca and Medina. So this part of the world, the fitna usually comes from that way. And it doesn't mean that the people there are evil people. Again, it's according to their actions. And great of the Imam, they came from the east. These hadiths needs to be understood in the proper way. And a person, as even some of the early generations of Islam said, if a person is from that place or the other and he hears these types of hadith, he should not feel good about himself, because it's not referring to him. Right? Him as a person is his deeds that would make him superior or not, or virtuous or not, and not necessarily the place that he was born or things of that nature. Then the next hadith, يقول حدثنا أبو ربيع الزهراني قال أبان محمد قال حدثنا أيوب قال حدثنا محمد أبي هريرة قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم جاء أهل اليمن هم أرق أفئدة الإيمان يماني والفقه يماني والحكمة يماني. That he said, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, the people of Yemen, they came and they are هم أرق أفئدة, they are the softest in their hearts. The hearts are soft. Al-Iman Yamani, the Iman is Yamani. That means also one of the things that people said is because Al-Ansar of Al-Madina, their origins are from Yemen. Right? But here the hadith, the Prophet said, Ja'a Ahlul Yaman, and he was in Al-Madina. So that means it's different. Those who are coming from Al-Yaman, they are soft in the hearts, and the Iman is Yamani. Wal-Fiqh, the understanding and knowledge, is also Yamani. Wal-Hikmatu Yamani. Al-Hikmah, the wisdom and matters of knowledge also is Yemen. So this is the Prophet ﷺ is praising those who would be steadfast among the people of Yemen. This is the hadith of shows the Iman. Then he says, حدثنا محمد بن مثنى قال حدثنا ابن أبي عدي حاء وحدثنا عمرو الناقد قال حدثنا إسحاق بن يوسف الأزرق كلاهما عن ابن عون عن محمد عن ابي هريره قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمثل سيم حديث. The next narration is also close. وحدثنا عون الناقد وحسن الحلواني قال حدثنا يعقوب وهو ابراهيم بن سعد قال حدثنا ابي عن صالح عن الاعرج قال قال ابو هريره رضي الله عنه قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اتاكم اهل اليمن هم اضعف قلوبا وارق افئده الفقه يماني والحكمه يماني. Here there is more. The Prophet ﷺ said, came to you the people of Yemen, and they are أضعف قلوبا وأرق أفئدة. أفئدة الفؤاد is also the heart, right? But the Prophet ﷺ mentioned here two synonyms of the same thing: القلب, which is the heart, and الأفئدة أو الفؤاد, which is also the heart. So they are the weakest in the hearts, meaning the hearts are weak, meaning it's soft. They get affected quickly, you know, with whenever they would hear, for example, listen to the Quran, have more fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They respond to the call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They get affected by calamities more, things of that nature. Different than those who have harshness in their hearts. They don't really care and so on. Then he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, al-fiqhu yamani wal-hikma yamani. Praise them. عليه الصلاة والسلام that the fiqh and the knowledge and the wisdom is also يمين. Then he says حدثنا يحيى بن يحيى قال قرأت على مالك عن أبي الزناد عن الأعرج عن أبي هريرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال رأس الكفر نحو المشرك والفخر والخيلاء في أهل الخير والإبل الفدادين. بعضهم قرأها الفدادين أهل الوبر والسكينة في أهل الغنم. Again, the Prophet ﷺ is saying رأس الكفر. That means the head of disbelief is towards the east. That means the fitan always comes from the east. That we don't need to repeat the matter again, right? It doesn't mean that the people are evil, right? Because people, their evilness or their goodness is according to their actions. Because human beings, when they fall into the trap of ignorance and foolishness, when they start classifying each other based on where they were born, the color of their skin, nationalities, ancestors, lineages, all of this, this is all jahiliyyah, right? This is all ignorance. So people think that we're living in the 21st century, that human beings are sophisticated. No, human beings are still the same human beings the way they were 2,000, 4,000 years ago. There's good and bad, and there's ignorance, and there is virtue, according to the good deeds and the bad deeds, right? So, as we see, you know, we even see clearly matters of racism and all of these types of things, and the whole world basically, except the believers, they are into this nationalism. What is that to do with the goodness of the person? You know, a person born in one part of the world, that means he has to be superior, because he's born in this land or that land. What is that to do with the actions of the person or his virtue or whatever? This is whoever does not see how foolish this matter is, yes, there's something wrong with him, right? And that's why in Islam we see how the matter is so clear. And we're all from Adam, as the Prophet ﷺ said, and Adam from dust. So human beings are human beings. But are the human beings all the same? No. Some are more virtuous than others. Some are better than others. By what? By their actions. So the iman, the faith, and their actions. This is what a person is responsible for. And this is how it elevates the person. So the fitan or the kufr, in the norm or more likely to come from the east, as the Prophet ﷺ said, وَالْفَخْرُ وَالْخُيَلَاءُ فِي أَهْلِ الْخَيْرِ وَالْإِبَلِ الْفَدَّدِينَ. And the fakhr, the pride and arrogance, is in the people of al-khayr, those who deal with horses a lot, and those who deal with the camels. And usually it was said that the person gets affected by the animals that he associates himself with, right? So if a person is not careful, he can be arrogant if he deals with horses and camels. This is what it means. It doesn't mean that the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, the Prophet used to ride the horses and they deal with camels and so on. And they were the best people ever brought to mankind. But in general, those who their life, and if you've seen those who du'at al-ibl, the shepherds of camels, are harsh, because the camels are very harsh. They get affected by the animals. Some way, somehow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And when you study the life of the camels and how they live, because they live a very harsh life, and their attitudes, they never forget, as they say, bad things that happens to them. Someone hurts them, they never forget it. They revenge even after so long, and they never forgive. And then whenever they fight, they would kill each other. There's no mercy in their life, you know what I mean? You know, and if one camel enters into the another male camel territory, like each male would have like 300 female or sea camels or something like this, and only one male. And if another male comes, you know, it has to be fight till death. There's nothing in between. And even the shepherds, they cannot separate. There's no way they get into each other's necks, and that's it, till one die. So, I mean, just, so the people, those who are associated with them and the harsh life that they live in, they become harsh like them. Right? So that means they need to work on the softness of the hearts, basically. And it doesn't mean that they're being condemned or so. And they usually they have to raise their voice, so they get used to it. So they become like this, loud voices. As the Bedouins will come to the message of the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Muhammad, like this, oh Muhammad, raise it, because they used to raise their voices. They do not have the manners where the Sahaba, they learned it from the Prophet ﷺ. So they would raise their voices, they would say harsh things. And this Bedouin attitude is not just for them. You would find some individuals in every community, they have this Bedouin attitude, right? They're harsh, they're loud in voice. They, you know, they don't care, they don't recognize others, things of that nature. So, أهل الوبر والسكينة في أهل الغنم, that means the sakina and the tranquility are the ones that have, those who deal with goats and sheep and so on. The shepherds of the goats and sheep, they are more, they have tranquility. And as the Prophet ﷺ said, there's no Prophet unless he was a shepherd. And he said, I did that also to some of the shepherds or the people of Makkah. So the shepherd with goats and sheep, he is more patient, right? And he deals with, and you would find him, and this is the true thing, you would find him softer. Soft individuals, and they deal, because they deal with these animals and so on. Another narration, يقول حدثنا يحيى بن أيوب وقتيبة بن حجر عن إسماعيل بن جعفر قال قال ابن أيوب قال حدثنا اسماعيل قال اخبرني علاء عن ابيه عن ابي هريره ان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الايمان يمان والكفر قبل المشرق والسكينه في اهل الغنم والفخر والرياء في الفدادين اهل الخير same hadith but with different order of the words الايمان يمان and the kufr is towards the east and السكينه tranquility in the people of الغنم the goats and sheep والفخر and proud and الرياء showing off in the people of horses and camels and so on. So the riyah is mentioned, showing off. And showing off is definitely an evil thing, because a person should do the deeds sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking the pleasure of people. The other narration also, حدثني حمد بن يحيى قال أخبرني موهب قال أخبرني يونس عن ابن شهاب قال أخبرني أبو سلمة بن عبد الرحمن عن أبا هريرة رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول الفخر والخيلاء في الفدادين أهل الورق والسكينة في أهل الغنم. The same thing with different orders of the sentences and few more narrations. وحدثنا عبد الله بن عبد الرحمن الدارمي أخبرنا أبو اليمان أخبرنا شعيب بن الزهري بهذا الإسناد مثله وزاد الإيمان يمان والحكمة يمانين. So the حكمة is mentioned here too. So we're just mentioning these narrations so that we don't miss any of the hadith. حدثنا عبد الله بن عبد الرحمن قال أخبرنا عن اليمان عن شعيب عن الزهري قال حدثني سعيد بن مسيب عن أبي هريرة قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول جاء أهل اليمن هم أرق أفئدة وأضعف قلوبا الإيمان يمان والحكمة يمانية السكينة في أهل الغنم والفخر والخيلاء في الفدادين أهل الورق قبل مطلع الشمس. So again, there's nothing new. In the other narration, حدثنا أبو وقف بن أبي شيبة وأبو كريم قال حدثنا أبو معاوية عن الأعمش عن أبي صالح عن أبي هريرة قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أتاكم أهل اليمن هم ألين قلوبا ألين is mentioned soft hearts وأرق أفئدة basically stressing the same thing that also the hearts are more softer, more lenient الإيمان يماني، الخوف يماني، والحكمة يمانية، رأس الخوف كبر المشاكل. ناظر العيسي حدثنا خضير بن سعيد وزهير بن حرب قال حدثنا جرير عن الأعمش بهذا الإسناد ولم يذكر رأس الكفر أو رأس الكفر كبر المشاكل. He mentioned the same chain of narration, but he did mention that the رأس of the كفر is towards the east. بيجيش إن شاء الله في الفيس أو فيس أو الريشن. كل حدثنا محمد بن مثنى قال حدثنا ابن أبي عدي حاء وحدثنا يوسف بن خالد قال حدثنا محمد يعني بن جعفر قال حدثنا شعبة عن الأعمش بهذا الأسناد مثل حديث جرير وزاد أني آدت والفخر والخيلاء في أصحاب الإبل. Again the pride and the arrogance and the people of camels والسكينة والوقار في أصحاب الشاة. And tranquility and waqar means a person is not a respectful person, someone that does not act in a foolish way, is in the people of Ash-Shah, those who the goats and the sheep. Another narration, يقول وحدثنا the last one, وحدثنا إسحاق بن إبراهيم قال أخبرنا عبد الله بن الحارث المخزومي عن ابن جريج قال أخبرني أبو الزبير أنه سمع جابر بن عبد الله يقول قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم غلظ القلوب والجفاء في المشرق والإيمان في أهل الحجاز. غلظ القلوب, the harshness of the hearts, والجفاء. الجفاء is dryness in manners or attitudes. It's something to do also with harshness. Is towards the east. And الجفاء is something that also when a person is not very soft, not a warm person in his actions, in his feelings, he's rough, he's dry, right? He does not have emotions, things of that nature. When the relationship between people have the jafa, that means they don't care about each other much. Everybody's so selfish and greedy. This is something you see also when people are living a materialistic life. And you feel the jafa. You don't feel that people care for one another. People that just want their own desires to be fulfilled. And the more the person humbles himself with worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more he will be away from this al-jafa or his harshness. والإيمان في أهل الحجاز and the إيمان in the people of أهل الحجاز. Now the next chapter, يقول باب بيان أنه لا يدخل الجنة إلا المؤمنون وأن محبة المؤمنين من الإيمان وأن إفشاء السلام سببا لحصولها. He gives the title, as we said, the Muslim is different than Imam al-Bukhari in the way that he makes his book. That's those who prefer it like Muslim because it's much clearer in the titles. Does not need too much of thinking of to show the relationship between the titles and the ahadith. Straightforward, different than the way of Imam al-Bukhari. Person needs to put more effort. And those who would say it's better because more effort are being done and more knowledge is to be sought this way. So he mentioned basically the ahadith that he will mention in the chapter, bayan, to make it clear that only the believers will enter Jannah, and that's no other than the believers will enter Jannah. And the love of the believers is from al-Iman, the love of the believers is from al-Iman. وَأَنَّ أَشَاءَ السَّلَامِ سَبَبًا لِحُصُولِهَا And to spread as-salam is one of the means to attain the love among the believers. And of course you've heard the hadith before. And the hadith يقول حدثنا أبو بكر بن أبي شيبة قال حدثنا أبو معاوية وكيع عن الأعمش عن أبي صالح عن أبي هريرة قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تدخلون الجنة حتى تؤمنوا. You would not enter Jannah till you believe. ولا تؤمنوا حتى تحبوا. And you would not believe till you love each other. أولا أدلكم على شيء إذا فعلتموه تحببتم. Should I inform you about something that if you do you would love each other? أفشوا السلام بينكم. Spread السلام among yourselves. So the statements are very clear. The first one, no one will enter Jannah till they are believers. The Jannah is forbidden for the disbelievers. Those who die in a state of disbelief, after the message has been explained to them and made clear to them, they will never enter Jannah. Those who die in a state of disbelief, but the message did reach them, they will be tested in the Day of Judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. So the Jannah is the place of those who are pure, and it's only the place of the believers. Not just the believers, but their iman has to be completed. Nobody will enter Jannah with a sin that is still, a person does not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from it, or forgiveness of Allah is not for the person, or is not punished. So either he repents to Allah, or if Allah forgive him, or that person will have to be punished so that he will enter Jannah in the pure state. Because Jannah, of course, is the most pure state. So no one will enter Jannah except the believers. And then he said, you would never attain the complete iman and faith till you love each other. Which also means you would never enter Jannah till you love each other. If you have hate towards the believers, that will prevent you from entering Jannah till that is taken care of. Either in this life or in the day of judgment, or in the hellfire. Right? So the person has to go through this level, these levels of purification, so that he will enter Jannah. One of which, see, the entire ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, this is a duty to be done. To have the love, but again, the love is levels according to the believers. So if a person is among the believers, even if his iman is so weak, and he has sins and so on, so the love for that person is present in the heart of the believer, but according to his actions again. Not according to anything else, according to his actions, and we don't judge what's in the hearts of the people, of course. And the more the person is righteous and doing the good deeds and so on, the more the believers, they would love that individual. Right? So it depends and it's different from one person to the other, but the foundation of that love is present. And people need to seek the means and to take the means to have this love towards one another. And if a person knows himself and he knows his sins and so on, he doesn't want people to treat him the same way that he would treat others. Because we're all sinners, right? And that's why the love to the believer is something that should be present in the hearts. And also this goes back to what people love each other for on the face of the earth, whether again it's because of the foolish things, the color of the skin, right? They have the same color, so they love each other more. Or if they are from the same countrymen, they love each other more. Right? And the whole entire world, except those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on, this is the norm. Right? Yeah, this is the bond that is between people. Something that has nothing to do with themselves or their actions or anything. Or, clubs that they are part of. Or they share a hobby together. Or whatever it is. So the souls, they like whoever is like them. So all of this, is that of any value? Or it's really one's actions and one's purpose of life. So that's why the highest level of love is the love for the sake of Allah. And that is for the believers. So the believers did not say the Americans or the Europeans or the Africans or the Indians or Pakistanis or Egyptians or Syrians. Iman, that's it. That's the only thing that brings the people together. So if the Iman is there, if the faith is there, comes with it the love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is the only bond that is present. The Quran, the ayat of the Quran says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, does not say, O you, this skin color or that skin color, or with this guy you have this place. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, and this is how people will be in their judgment. Their judgment, they return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're not going to be carrying the flags of the country, right? And I'm from this land, so that means I need to be more superior than others. What people, they go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with their actions, whether it's good or bad. So if a person wants, if things are not clear, the easiest way is to go with our hearts to the hereafter and see what's going to happen in the day of judgment and hereafter, and this is how we should live our life in this life. To seek victory and to be superior on the face of earth. For what reason? For people to feel good and not to be humiliated? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He mentioned this for the believers, it's about Jannah and not about this world. أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ وَلَمَّا يَأْتِيكُمْ مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِن قَبْلِكُمْ مَسَّتْهُمُ الْبَأْسَاءُ وَالضَّرَّاءُ وَزُلْزِلُوا حَتَّى يَقُولَ رَسُولُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. When the messengers of Allah and their companions will see when is the victory of Allah, because they have been tested so much with difficulties and they're shaking and so on. The beginning of the ayah, do you think that you will enter Jannah without knowing what happened to the nations before? So when the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they went with the Prophet ﷺ, they fought for the sake of Allah when they were weak and so on and they became superior, it was not about being established on the face of earth. This was not their goal. The goal was not to be established on the face of earth and to have power and to win and to have the glory of being powerful. This was not the reason why they do whatever they did. It was about Jannah. They wanted to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is how they do all their actions, as the ayah mentioned. So if the victory or superiority on the face of earth is not for the Jannah, meaning for the sake of Allah, even if it's from the Muslims, this can be bring the total opposite for them. It can bring the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on them. If it's not for the sake of Allah, seeking the pleasure of Allah. That's why the Prophet at the highest time of victory, when he entered Mecca, usually people when they conquer a city or they win in a fight, they go in a very arrogant way and celebrations and so on. The Prophet he entered Mecca on his head like as if he's making ruku'ah, humbling himself, alayhi salatu wasalam, in a moment where usually those who do these things they have so much pride. He went like this, right, alayhi salatu wasalam, and making salah in the Kaaba, in Mecca, and forgiving people. You know, they were not people going after the glory of this life or the materialistic things. They were going after the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So see how the hadith led to the Jannah. The concern is to enter the Jannah. But if the concern is to be is this life, then the hadith does not apply here. And that's why the only way for the believers to be upright is to be very focused on the fact that they are seeking the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all of their affairs. If this is clear, then the path will be clear, no confusion whatsoever. So anything that we do in our life, is that thing is going to get me to go to Jannah or to the hellfire, or if there's no benefit to it whatsoever. So لا تدخل الجنة حتى تؤمن, you will never enter Jannah till you believe, and you will not believe till you love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Prophet informed his ummah about a practical way, a very easy way. If it's done, they would love each other and therefore they would complete their iman and therefore they would enter Jannah, which is أفشوا السلام بينكم. And أفشوا السلام, for us to apply this, has to be applied exactly as the Prophet said. أفشوا means spread the salam. Not to give it, we talked about that before. A salam, or to give salam, is not to specific people only. It's not to the ones that you know. It's for every believer. This is the right of the Muslim. And to spread it on the one that you know and the one that you do not know. And while the person is giving the salam is not a word of saying hi or how are you. It's saying assalamu alaikum or assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah or assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sincere dua from the heart that the person is safe from all harm in this life and the hereafter, that his iman is complete, that he has the concern towards him, and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be on him, and the blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the believers, they have this in their hearts towards one another, and they would say this to the ones that they do not know. When this is present in their hearts and they say, this definitely brings the love, as the Prophet ﷺ said. But the sad case is when we find enmity and all of this, it's because of the attachment to this world and weakness of iman and sins and arrogance and khusumat fi deen, fighting over matters of deen and things like this, and all of because maybe hasad, envy, or different personalities. Sometimes a person, when he becomes he wants to be a good Muslim, or embrace Islam, or repent to Allah, people are of different personalities, right? So when a person repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're supposed to change. But sometimes we only change certain things and we don't change everything else. And we start acting with each other not based on the deen of Islam, but based on how we were before we make salah, for example, or the way that we were raised. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, خيروكم في الجاهلية خيروكم في الإسلام. They are faqih. The best among you in jahiliyyah, times of ignorance, are the best among you in Islam, if they will have knowledge. Right? And as one of the early generations, I think Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahimahullah, he was asked, what is the best way, how to save oneself, or so, how, something like a question of how to be a good person, or so. And then he said to have gharizatul aql, or something like this, that you have good intellect, that you're wise, that you're basically following the deen of an Islam with wisdom to follow the truth. He said, if a person doesn't have this, then he said to him, then husnul adab, to have good manners. If you don't have this, you have good manners. If you have good manners, you know how to ask and follow the righteous ones and so on. He said, what if he doesn't have this? He said, yell them songs. Then he should be quiet. If he doesn't have both, then he should be silent. He said, what if he doesn't have this? Then فَلْيَعُدَّ نَفْسَهُ الْمَوْتِ. He said, then he should prepare himself to die. There's no goodness in him. If he does not even have, if he cannot be one of this, then what is the goodness of him to be living on the face of it? So again, the way if it's applied, the Prophet does not speak from his desire, he speaks from revelation from Allah, and that's how the sincerity should be present in heart. يقول حدثني جهير بن حرب قال أبانا جرير عن الأعمش بهذا الإسناد قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم والذي نفسي بيده لا تدخلون الجنة حتى تؤمن. The same narration, but this time the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم swearing by Allah والذي نفسي بيده, by the one that my soul is in his hands, swearing by Allah that he would never enter الجنة till you believe till the end of the hadith. And why, as we mentioned this before, why would the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم swear by Allah when he's already the most truthful among all human beings, alayhi salatu wasalam? Because what is being said, if you say it to a person like this, the human being, they don't get it right away. It has to be wahy, it has to be revelation from Allah. Because many people would even would read this hadith and would say, is it truly like this? Like, you will not enter Jannah till you believe. Okay. And you won't believe till you love each other? Is that easy, that simple? And if you spread the salam, you love each other, a person sometimes might not see that this is really the steps to attain this. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ is swearing by Allah. Right? Because this is, it's truly as the Prophet ﷺ said. So if it's not happening, that means people are not applying it the way the Prophet ﷺ said. We'll take the last chapter, then the deen is al-nasiha, the deen is the nasiha. As we defined al-nasiha before, as the ulama they defined it, اهتمام قلب الناصح المنصوح له, the concern of the heart of the person that has the nasiha towards the subject of the nasiha. As the previous, this is linked to the previous chapter, comes with the love. When you love, you love your children, for example, you're so concerned towards them. You want to do the best for them. And this is no doubt that is present in the heart of every father and mother. They might ruin their children, right, because of the ignorance or the lack of the proper knowledge, although they never had this in the heart. No father or mother would say, today I'm going to take a few steps to ruin my children. Nobody would say that, but in reality, in their actions, sometimes they do that. When they ignore their upbringing, when they raise them in the wrong way, and so on. But in the hearts, they have the concern. So the concern of every Muslim, this is, as we said, the Prophet ﷺ, whenever you take the hedge of people, when they embrace Islam, when they become a Muslim, immediately he would take from them that their hearts will have the concern towards every Muslim. So the hearts of the believers, they are concerned towards one another. How to benefit them, whether it's in matters of deen, how to enjoy good and forbid evil, how to help those who are ignorant, how to, and so on, to always have the concern towards them, and also matters of dunya. They're hungry, they're starving, they're happy, they're, whatever there is. So this is part of the deen of Islam, is to be concerned towards the whole entire ummah, not just the individuals as it comes in the hadith. This is a deen. The deen is al-nasiha, as the Prophet ﷺ said. يقول حدثنا محمد بن عباد المكي قال حدثنا سفيان قال قلت لسهيل إن عمر حدثنا عن القعقاع عن أبي قال ورجلت أن يسقط عني رجلا قال فقال سمعته من الذي سمعه منه أبي كان صديقا له الشاه. ثم حدثنا سفيان عن سهيل عن عطاء بن يزيد عن تميم الداري أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الدين النصيحة. الدين النصيحة. The deen is النصيحة. And as we see the precise wording of the Prophet ﷺ, that ad-deen, this religion, is al-nasiha. You can explain the entire religion from the perspective of al-nasiha, that concern towards the subject of the nasiha. قلنا لمن تهوء رفض الله النصيحة should be قال لله ولكتابه ورسوله ولأئمة المسلمين وعامتهم. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the nasiha to Allah. That means your heart is concerned towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to worship Him alone. When the heart is occupied, how can I please Allah? How can I worship Him alone? Obey the orders of Allah. Get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes. Concern. This is His concern. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa li kitabihi, and to the book of Allah, to have the concern towards the Quran. And the concern towards the Quran is to learn it, to recite it, to memorize it, to act according to the Quran. And really, we don't need to be reminded as much. It's something that has to be in our system every day. We learn something new from the Quran. Whoever wants blessings in his time, he should read Quran. Whoever wants all goodness in his life and the hereafter, he should read Quran. You read some of the statements of the early generations of Islam, amazing when it comes to the Quran. Like one of the Tabi'een, he said, they used to, he said that whenever he would walk to the Fajr Salah, right, there is no house unless he hears the Quran. That's before Fajr. They're going to the Masjid, and the houses of the Sahaba and the Tabi'een after the Prophet ﷺ, there's nobody sleeping at this time. Doing what? Reading Quran. They can hear the humming of the people in their houses reading Quran. And that's why even when one of the early generations of Islam, he went to visit his friend before Fajr and he found him sleeping. He said, I didn't know that people sleep at this time. Right? They used to make their life alive with the Quran. So in their homes, in their masajid, they would sit and read Quran and occupy the masjid with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to have the concern to the book of Allah. Imam Nawawi rahimahullah, he said, when he mentioned that the maximum numbers of days where Muslims should read the Quran, the entire Quran from the beginning to the end, and of course for those who know how to read, and for those who do not know how to read, they should have the concern, how am I going to read the Quran? And they would put the effort every day, some portion of their time, till they get to read the Quran. And Allah made the Quran easy. But the effort has to be there. And if a person spends a month, 2 months, 3 months, a year, it doesn't matter. After that, he'll be able to recite the Quran. So he said that the maximum number of days where after that a person would be among those who make hajj of the Quran, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh Allah, my people took the Quran as mahjur, deserted. Right, they put it behind their backs, complaining to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, if you want to be not among what the ayah says, you have to finish the Quran the most, the maximum, 40 days. Right? And he said the 40 days are for al-di'af, wa kathiri al-shughl, this is for the bad people, 40 days and the weak ones. And those who are too busy, some people are too busy working, too busy, whatever, then that's the max for them. So it wasn't known at that time that someone would live months and months without going through the entire Quran. It was not something that is in the system, basically. That's why the famous, or the well-known khatma of the Sahaba was in 7 days. This was the majority of them, the norm, that they would finish every 7 days, right, the Quran. First 30 days, 2 weeks, 40 days, a person says that if I finish in 40 days, I will spend half of the day reading Quran because I'm not able to read Quran. Then start to learn how to read Quran. But to live our life, not reading the Quran, we get excited maybe in the month of Ramadan, we start learning a couple of days and then we quit. And then a year passes, if that year passed in learning, after the year, the person will be fluent, inshallah ta'ala, in reading. And the reading is one aspect only. And of course, if a person can memorize, if a person can act. But and there are many statements about this, about how reading the barakah and the blessings. But the point here that the concern towards the Book of Allah, to have the concern towards the Book of Allah, where a person would read the Quran. One of the religions, he said, I used to complain of no barakah in my time. He doesn't have barakah, as we all complain about the same thing. So he said, and I increased my wisdom of the Quran. So I increased the portion of the Quran that I read every day. And the more he said I increase it, the more barakah I get from my time. Till he would finish the Quran every 3 days. And he has more time than he used to have before. The Quran would never let the person down if it's not sincerely for the sake of Allah. And the thing that even the kibar of the ulama, you would find in their statements, the one thing that they regret, although they were busy studying the deen, you would find towards the end of their life, or so more than one, would say that he would regret that he did not give more time to the Quran. The Shaykh Hussain Thani rahimahullah. And he said that, and more would say this. So this is the real regret, and because of the lack of the concern towards the Quran. وَلِكِتَابِهِ وَلِرَسُولِهِ To have the nasiha towards the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, how am I going to follow the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, to learn, to have the concern, getting to know the life of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, his speech, his actions, to follow him, to truly follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in all of our affairs. Not once in a while we hear something and the deen becomes on the side of our life. وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلِأَئِمَّةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ And to the a'imma of the Muslims, to the leaders of the Muslims, to have concern towards them. That's what the Prophet ﷺ said. How can a person have the concern towards them? To make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them, not against them like most of the ummah they do. Even if they are zalimeen and transgressors and this and that. As Imam Ahmad rahimahullah said, if I have a da'wah, it would have been to the leader of the Muslims, because if Allah guides him, he will guide nations with him, right? So making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's nothing wrong with making dua against someone that is an oppressor. It's permissible if a person is oppressed, yes. But to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, it comes on his own. But to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them, not to revolt against them even if they are oppressors and wrongdoers and so on. It is not permissible whatsoever to overthrow them, to go to protest and make revolutions and all of these things. It's against the deen. Clearly, as the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ mentioned this, and most of the calamities that afflicted the Ummah is because of this. Because of this enmity between the Muslims one another and so on and so forth. But rather, people, if they have the nasiha to Allah and His book and to His Messenger ﷺ, and they spread that among the people, and they advise and they enjoy good and forbid evil, and have patience, if these oppressors put them in prison or whatever, they are patient and they're calling people to the deen of Allah and so on. So to a'immati al-Muslimin, if a person wants to advise them, he goes to them. And after jihad, kalimatu haqqin 'inda sultanin ja'il, the best of jihad is to say the word of truth by an unjust ruler. That means you go to him and you tell him, right? And if he kills you as a result of this, this is the best, you know, that you can do. But not to cause fitan and so on. So the a'immati al-Muslimin wa'ammatihim. And of course, part of the a'immati al-Muslimin, not to obey them in the ma'asiyah. Not to obey them if they order you to do haram. No obedience. Because the obedience is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the same nasiha should be if a parent would order the child to do something haram. The nasiha towards the parent is that you do not become a reason for them to enter the hellfire. Because if you obey them, you're basically leading them astray and bringing the wrath of Allah on them. And وَلِأَمَّةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَعَمَّتِهِمْ عَمَّتِهِمْ means the masses of the Muslims. The people are either leaders or not leaders. So the whole Ummah, to have the concern towards the Muslims, individual-wise and nations and so on, and to have that concern with the dua to help them to educate the ignorant one, the one that doesn't have knowledge. We're always having issues or problems that, for example, we can't find someone to teach the kids Quran, for example. Right? If somebody knows how to recite Surah Al-Fatiha and someone else doesn't know how to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, this is, we can teach Surah Al-Fatiha how to recite it. Doesn't mean that we have to wait for the person to be alim for this. You know, teaching someone how to read Quran, for example, if you know how to read Quran. Helping others even to earn halal money. You have a skill that others don't have, so you help a person so that he can earn halal money, so you help him for free. The concern towards the believers, each person Allah gave him something, that he would help others. I don't want to keep you for long, but this is the hadith of al-Nasiha, and the hadith came with different narrations, but we'll continue that inshallah. Probably Maybe tomorrow or maybe not, and not Saturday. But if we start there, inshallah ta'ala, we'll continue maybe through Skype or something. But inshallah, we should try to finish the Kitab al-Iman and what comes after that, inshallah. Sallallahu aleyhi ve sellem.